What's up, y'all? Gerald here, creator of Gospel Chops and your host for this YouTube channel, back with another video. Now, I know that a lot of viewers of my channel do not follow NFL football, but you missed a gem on Sunday after the New Orleans Saints game when Demario Davis took the stage. He stepped up to the mic. They expected him to talk about the defense and talk about the game. He said, "I'm on assignment. I have another agenda. I'm doing God's work today. Let me go ahead and testify about the goodness of God in my life." Shout out to all the fathers out there in YouTube land. No, not the baby daddies. No, not the absentee dudes. Not the sperm donors. The actual fathers that love their families and go out and slay dragons every day and live up to their responsibilities. Let's get into what this brother had to say, and I'll save my fire. I'll keep my powder dry until after the video. Let's get into this.
Am I good to go?
Yes, sir.
Oh, man, I got a lot to say, so y'all buckle up. I started to realize something. Man, we play this game on Sundays, and it's really the Lord's day. And the day we should be worshiping the Lord, a lot of times players are getting worshiped, and we get to go on this ball field. So since so many of us didn't get to go to church today, I have a word that I want to share. I know this is a little untraditional, so like I said, buckle up. Revelations 3:20 says, "See, I stand at the door and knock. If anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I will come in and dine with him and eat with him and he with me." I want to tell y'all about a knock that I heard this week. A lot of people don't know this, but on Friday, my daughter, she's 4 years old. She had her third epilepsy seizure attack. It's my same daughter who survived retinoblastoma. She's been totally clear to that, but she had her third seizure. And it's been almost 2 years. She was about a month away. If she would have had no seizures for one more month, then she would have been off the medicine. But now we have to start that clock all the way over. It was on Friday when a bunch of kids were over the house and she was playing. And I noticed something was off. And I told her mom I thought she was having a seizure. Her mom is pretty good. She saw it, my wife. And we took her in her room, didn't want to cause a scene. And she started to foam at the mouth. And it was her worst seizure. For 30 minutes, she seized. She wouldn't come, and we had to call the paramedics. They came. And so over the course of time, it ended up being a total of 30 minutes. They got her in. My wife got in the paramedics with her. I got behind them driving. You can imagine all the thoughts that's racing through your mind. The last sight you see of your daughter is she's totally out of it. Got to the hospital, and my wife told me that my daughter stopped breathing in the car twice. So I'm, of course, praying. We get to the hospital. They give a bunch of medicine. They should seize to stop. She's laying there. And at this point, if she sees for 30 minutes, you start to fear there could be development issues that could mess with her brain. You know, she stopped breathing. If there was no oxygen going to her brain, you know, you're starting to think about her speech be slurred or anything or worse. So we prayed and we prayed, and she had medicine, and my wife and I had to stay overnight at the hospital. And in the middle of the night, probably about 3 o'clock, I heard a knock. And the knock was my daughter. I prayed for her. I said, "God, let this just be an attack from the enemy that's just trying to be a distraction, and let him have overplayed his hand, and my daughter come back stronger than before." When I heard my daughter talk in the middle of the night, and my daughter, she doesn't have any development issues, praise God. She doesn't have any slurred speech, you know, prior to this. She woke up talking clearer than she was talking before. Now, anyone who deal with epilepsy knows that it takes a few days for them to come back. You know, they usually can get back to normal wherever they were, but it takes a couple of days. They're groggy. It's a lot because what their body is like, it's like the TV just staticking in their brain. She was talking clearer than before, and it was 3 o'clock, and we heard her talk, and we let her talk for about 20 minutes and said, "Hey, baby, it's nighttime. Let's go back to sleep." You know, and I just prayed. I started saying, "Praise God, praise God." The next morning when she got up, my daughter was so sharp. She was able to talk to me and her mom. I mean, clear conversation. She's sharp for a 4-year-old. No stuttering. All her words clear. And my daughter, like I said, my daughter is already sharp. She was sharper than before. And if any of you were able to have a conversation with my daughter, you wouldn't know anything had ever happened. So we had a birthday party for my 7-year-old daughter that day. She got to be released from the hospital and she came back home. And it was as if nothing was happening. She was playing with the kids the day before. And she had the worst seizure that she had ever had. And the next day, she's back out there playing with the kids. Now, of course, we can't let her get overstimulated. We have to keep bringing her in. Have to keep cooling her down. Can't let her do too much just because of protocol. But when I tell you, I got a chance to hear a knock from God. And what I want to share is we get to play this game and it's great. And there's so many amazing things that happen in that game. And everybody wants to hear about them. But when we go lead this game, we go back to being regular people. And regular people are living life. And people are waiting for a knock. And the word says who Jesus is, he's knocking at the door. All you got to do is get up. And so on the way, man, I'm nervous, but I'm praying. And I'm trusting. And I'm believing. And I'm asking for my daughter to make it through. I'm asking that she's better than before. And God gave me just what I asked for, plus some. I was blown away. And at that point, I knew, well, the game is going to take care of itself. My knock had already been answered. And I just want people to know, like, if you got stuff going on in your life, lay it before the Lord. Lay it before the Lord and trust. And be expecting of a knock. Because the word says what you have to do is you have to get up and open the door. He's not going to open the door for you. He's going to knock. But you have to be listening and waiting for the knock. And when you see it, you have to get up and open the door. And your blessing is going to be there. Now, I'm going to be here to talk about football next week. I wish y'all well. Happy Sunday and praise God. Thank y'all.
Now, there you have it, y'all. Did that statement, did that testimony hit you like it hit me? I'm listening to this brother and I'm just in awe. Because I understand. We should all understand. Everyone knows someone who has dealt with a child with medical issues. It might be you. It might be someone you know. But like I said in the beginning of this video, fathers, not sperm donors, not baby daddies, fathers, embrace their responsibility as leaders of their family, as the giant slayers, as the dragon slayers that go out and do what they got to do every day to support their family. When you have a sick child, it hurts fathers in a special way because you have to come to grips with the fact that you can't fix it. As a father, people in your family come to you and you say, just tell me what the problem is so I can fix it. Don't overtalk it. I don't want to hear all that. Just tell me what it is and let me get to work and fix it and you be quiet while I work. Y'all know how that go. But in a situation with a sick child, a father has to come to the grips with the fact that he can't do anything about it. And I've told you before on this channel that part of being a man is having a relationship with your Creator. And in that moment, when a father realizes that he can't fix a problem, if he's a man, based on my description, then he has a relationship with God. And in his weakness, he knows to lean on God as his strength. This man's daughter had a seizure. She was in the ambulance going to the hospital. There was nothing he could do but pray. But lean on God. And had he not allowed God into his life before, what could he have done in that situation? It would have been hopeless for him. But he went to Revelation 3:20, and it gave him reassurance. I'm going to read Revelation 3:20-21. Behold, I stand at the door and knock. If any man hear my voice and open the door, I will come in to him and will sup with him, and he with me. To him that overcometh will I grant to sit with me in my throne, even as I also overcame and am set down with my Father in his throne. The Lord is saying, behold, I stand at the door and knock. Will you let me in? Can I walk through the doorway of your heart and sup with you? If you allow me to, I will rock with you and your family. I will ride with you. I will be with you. And in your moments of weakness, when you find that there's nothing you can do, look to me, because I'm sitting right here with you. I got you. And because you let me in, this is how good he is, y'all. Because you let me in, I'm going to allow you a seat at my throne, just as I had a seat at the throne of my Father. And this word from the third chapter of Revelation was to the Laodiceans. So I came across this information. I said, well, who were the Laodiceans? Well, the book of Wikipedia revealed unto me, y'all, the words attributed to the Laodiceans may mark an ironic overconfidence in regard to spiritual wealth. They are unable to recognize their bankruptcy. However, the image may also be drawing on the perceived worldly wealth of the city. The city was a place of great finance and banking. That's the Laodiceans in Revelation 3. So who were they? They were the boule. They were the bourgeoisie Negroes. They were the uppity ones with the college degrees and the big bank accounts. I saw one writer said they were lukewarm. And we know what the Bible says about lukewarm. But they were comfortable in their status. They were comfortable in the bag they had obtained. They didn't lean so much on God because they had stuff. And yet they were told, behold, I stand at the door and knock. If any man hear my voice and open the door, I will come into him and will sup with him and he with me. Demario Davis at this post-game presser impressed me and gave me everything I needed in his testimony to know that he's not just a father, he's a man. A man who has a relationship with his creator. And in a moment of need, in a moment of weakness, in a moment where he couldn't slay that dragon for his family, he depended on God. He depended on his faith. We don't talk these things on this channel for no reason. And I'm glad that situations like this can affirm what we already know. No, we don't need his testimony. We got our own testimonies. You have a testimony that I don't have. I have one that you don't have. But it encourages me to see the testimony of others because it assures me that God is not only working in my life, those things that I can see and touch and feel, but he's working in the lives of others and even prominent brothers like this who have achieved in life, have not gotten so far up that mountain that they have lost faith. He's still clinging to God. This was his microphone moment. And he said, I know y'all want me to talk about the game, but you know what? I'm gonna talk about God and what he did for me and my family. And you know the telling part of this whole situation? The icing on the cake of God's blessing? Demario Davis plays for none other than the Saints. Yeah. Like the video. Subscribe to the channel and share the video so we can get more people involved in the conversation, y'all. And like I always say, always remember and never forget, without the gospel, it's just chops. Until next time. Peace.